Championship Wrestling, bringing you great wrestling action sanctioned by the NWA, the National Wrestling Alliance.
Gentlemen, this feature event on World Championship Wrestling is one fall with a 30-minute time limit. First of all, introducing the leader of the Four Horsemen, here is James J. Dillon. James J. Dillon. And introducing the U.S. Heavyweight Champion from Sweetwater, Texas, weighing in at 260 pounds, Barry Windham. His opponent is from the state of Tennessee, weighing in at 222 pounds, Hot Stuff, Eddie Gilbert. Now let's go down to Jim Ross.
Thank you very much, Tony Schiavone. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we do have a tremendous hour in store for you here today. You will not only see the United States and the World Tag Team Champions in action, Missy Hyatt has a special feature where the World's Heavyweight Champion, Nature Boy Ric Flair, and the World Television Championship rematch here on the program today. Rick Steiner and Mike Rotunda all in our program here, and we'll be back right after this. Time out.
It's World Championship Wrestling, the Stars of the NWA, the Richmond Coliseum, Richmond, Virginia. Saturday, January 28th, 8 o'clock in Richmond, the Scope Coliseum in Norfolk, Virginia. Friday, January 27th, 8 o'clock at the Norfolk Scope, Civic Center, Roanoke, Virginia. Thursday, January 26th, 7:30 at the Roanoke Civic Center, Veterans Memorial Coliseum, Jacksonville, Florida. Wednesday, January 25th, 7:30 in Jacksonville, the Ocean Center in Daytona Beach. On Tuesday, January 24th, 7:30 in Daytona Beach, the Bayfront Center in St. Petersburg. On Monday, January 23rd, 7:30 in St. Pete, Municipal Auditorium, Kansas City, Missouri. Saturday, January 21st, 8 o'clock in Kansas City. There you'll see Barry Windham, the Road Warrior, Sting, many others. The Keel in St. Louis. Friday, January 20th, 8 o'clock in St. Louis. The Nature Boy, Ric Flair, the Junkyard Dog, Lex Luger, Dick Murdoch, and others in St. Louis. Civic Center in Savannah. Tuesday, January 17th, 7:30. There you'll see Paulie Dangerously, the original Midnight Express, Rick Steiner, others in Savannah. The Coliseum in Macon, Georgia. Monday, January 16th, 7:30 in Macon, Jim Cornette, the Midnight Express, the Junkyard Dog, Barry Windham, others in Macon. The Fairgrounds Coliseum in Dallas, Texas. Tomorrow night at 7:30. There you'll see the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, Sting, Rick Steiner, the Road Warriors, many in Dallas. And the Kaiser Convention Center in Oakland, California. Tonight, bell time, 8 o'clock. The Road Warriors, the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, many other top stars. Tonight, 8 o'clock at the Kaiser Convention Center in Oakland, California. It's the NWA, the Major League of Professional Wrestling. This match has just started. Barry Windham against Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert. And it's a rematch of sorts right here on World Championship Wrestling, Jim Ross.
Special challenge issued to Barry Windham by Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert. That challenge obviously accepted right here. Superstation TBS, collar and elbow tie-up. Windham reversed it and puts Gilbert back in the corner. Goes for a right hand. Gilbert blocked it. The youngster from Knoxville or from Lexington, Tennessee, has really been incensed with, in recent weeks, at the actions of J.J. Dillon and the Horsemen. He is not intimidated, I can guarantee you that. And that is evidence of that fact.
And I think if we go back not too long ago, right here on Superstation TBS, we'll find out that Barry Windham and James J. Dillon's attitude going into that match certainly much different than it is here tonight.
They're not overconfident here. They know that this is a great young superstar, standing vertical suplex by the United States heavyweight champion as he backs Eddie Gilbert to the rope, stretching for the lariat. He missed it. Gilbert caught him. A great clothesline by Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert, countering an attempted lariat by Barry Windham.
In all sports, there's momentum, and certainly the momentum is right on the side of Eddie Gilbert. And he has a real feisty temper that our referee, Teddy Long, is trying to cool down right there, but he has what we call a controlled temper, and that's a temper that has been able to propel him to many wins and not really get the best of him where he would lose control of the match and thus lose a match.
Windham puts it back in the corner, a deep shot on the break. He buried the right hand and now the foot to the midsection of young Eddie Gilbert. hot stuff. What a right hand. The United States heavyweight champion, 6'6", 265. Gilbert gives away a lot of inches and a lot of pounds, but nothing in the heart. Gilbert has got that fighting heart that cannot, I don't think, be matched in this sport.
I really don't think the size is any issue anymore with Eddie Gilbert. We've talked about it so much, about his fighting heart. Coming back once again, wanting to take on Barry Windham, and really giving the U.S. champion all he can handle right here. Head scissors by Eddie Gilbert. Windham showing his agility. Butt out, and what a right hand. Well, that was from downtown. Downtown and unexpected. Also, he came right out of it with a solid right hand. A lot of times, you know, Jim, we've seen him come out of headlocks. Maybe he's even scouted Barry Windham coming out of headlocks or head scissors with a headlock of his own, but he came with a right hand, a good move. If you just joined us, fans, this is one of two big television main events here on Superstation TBS tonight. The other, of course, the big rematch for the television title. Rick Steiner defending against Mike Rotunda. That comes later in our program. Windham goes right hand, taking his toll on Eddie Gilbert. If it breaks into a slugfest, Windham quite obviously is going to have the advantage as he pounds those right hands, but Gilbert jumps right back up. He will not stay down. That was a good point. He doesn't want to get in a slugfest with Barry Windham, but he will if it permits. And I tell you what, he's going right after him, and he's got the U.S. champion in a lot of trouble right here. Hot stuff. Eddie Gilbert really teed off on the United States heavyweight champion in this special challenge event here on Superstation TBS. This is a kind of intense competition the fans on the West Coast will see tonight in Oakland, California, or tomorrow night in the Metroplex in the great state of Texas. Fans of Dallas and Fort Worth excited about the return of the NWA tomorrow night at the State Fair Coliseum. Notice now, as you take a look at Eddie Gilbert, that very little bit tentative. He's telling Eddie to come on after me, but he's been taking a lot of steps backward, and that's certainly in the favor of Eddie Gilbert. These men have so many parallels in their career. That's Windham follows with another right hand. Both second-generation wrestlers, both former pro wrestling rookies of the year.
Hey, come on, man.
Been around the sport their entire lives. Their fathers, both successful professional wrestlers in their own right. Side salt hosted by Barry Windham, and the champion is really turning on here to try to snuff the enthusiasm and the momentum out of hot stuff Eddie Gilbert. Although very deliberate right here with Eddie Gilbert. He has such great endurance, and we have seen it so many times with Gilbert. Notice how deliberately Barry is executing these moves on Eddie Gilbert. He keeps doing this. Gilbert's going to have a chance to come back again and again. A lot of guys would have just packed their bags and gone home after what Eddie Gilbert's endured with a horseman. But right here, this shows what kind of man he is. Sends him off the top. That'll equalize any size disadvantage. You saw on our screen, and there he is, the world champion. Nature Boy Ric Flair is out here at ringside with James J. Dillon. So you know there's concern in the horseman camp.
Indeed, you're right, Tony. There is great concern in the horseman camp regarding this youngster. Inverted atomic drop. And Windham perhaps puts the stopper for now on hot stuff Eddie Gilbert.
Well, they're on a roll. He comes on national television, says he's not going to wrestle Lex Luger ever again. And that situation, of course, will be discussed in a special feature that Missy Hyatt has done with Nature Boy Ric Flair. There you see the champion. I'll tell you, we talked about attitudes. The attitudes have changed since these men first met here on Superstation TBS. Gilbert is even more intense. He's competing with all he's got. And Windham, as you mentioned, Tony, is much more focused. He's much more serious about this youngster than he was a few weeks ago. Well, Ric Flair called him a thinking man's champion, and there's no doubt we've been very, very impressed, not only with the athletic ability, but the intellect in the ring of Barry Windham. But the same thing can be said for Eddie Gilbert. He's a thinking man's wrestler. Not a champion right now, but certainly right on the threshold of being one. Those shots are perfectly executed, though, to the midsection. Got him up in the suplex position. Carries him around the ring. Is he going to drop him? That's what he's going to do. Great control exhibited by that man, the United States heavyweight champion, Barry Windham. And once again, Gilbert fights right back up to his feet. Barry Windham walked around kind of in a slow serve. I don't know if that looked
on J.J. Dillon was discussed or not. But once again, Gilbert rises up, like you said, Jim Ross. He will just not go down. And now here's where the trouble may begin, right at the feet of Flair and James J. Dillon. Like a bunch of bullies just surrounding this kid. J.J. taunting him. Of course, Ric Flair always talking. Right hand by Barry Windham. I hope this thing doesn't get out of control.
This is why I'm the best here.
Once again, a little bit of cockiness will not go a long way in this sport. Eddie got right to him, Jim. Tony Aragus will get you defeated in the ring with Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert. He is a great young superstar, and he is fighting with all he has right here. Windham goes for the ride. He's elevated by the youngster from Tennessee, lateral press. Near fall, he got a two count out of it. There was a look of disbelief on Ric Flair's face right there momentarily as Eddie Gilbert came firing back. But then again, you see Barry Windham. What a great champion. Coming right up again. Both men giving it their all in our first event here on this great program. Windham measures him and tees off on him one more time. This is one of the most physically intense contests that we have ever witnessed here in the studios of Superstation TBS between two of the top stars in our sport today. Front face lock is going to set him a look like for a suplex. Standing vertical suplex. He's 6'6", what an awesome move. Rolls over, he didn't break by in the leg.
Not at all.
But he still didn't grapevine the leg. But we've seen Barry Windham in this situation against Eddie Gilbert have that confident smirk on his face. He didn't have it there. He was unsure of himself. And I really think that he really lost his concentration right there. Gilbert with an amateur roll up there. Got a near fall out of him while Windham was debating with Teddy Long about the officiating. There's nothing wrong with the officiating. He needs to focus on Eddie Gilbert. That's where his problem lies. Notice Eddie. Look at him. Every time he goes down, he reaches for the rope or tries to pull himself up some way or the other, but he continues to get up. Blatant wreck of the eyes of Barry Windham. Windham will take every cheap shot known in the sport. Now he's biting him, for goodness sake. That's the first time I've ever seen Barry Windham do that. And it may be a move of desperation here. Nothing else has been able to put the young man down for good. Why not that? How much more punishment can he take?
Superplex.
Here comes the superplex. You're right. JJ's clapping his hands like this is going to be it. Big right hand, and he knocked him off the top rope right on the apron. Now he's got to get some expensive energy to put him back up there again, if in fact that's the move he wants to use. But I think for Barry Windham to execute the superplex, he's got to do it immediately. He's not going to go for that now. Oh, yes, he is going to put him back up there. He's got to execute it immediately or he'll be in trouble. He's looking around, Jim. He can't do that. J.J. Dillon says, we'll let him have it right here. Well, Gilbert's trying feverishly to block it, to set back down and set out on him. Windham's fighting to get him up, and Windham's having a hard time doing it. Gilbert's blocking. There's a punch right to the midsection by Eddie. Once again, he's waited too long, and now he's going to have to try to punish him again to get him over. It's a very, very physical move, not only to be put in one, but to execute it. He finally did it. He finally got him over, Jim. That will be it. There's no doubt that should be it right here. The superplex. He's not trying to pin the man. This is an arrogant young man right here, the United States champ. You talk about someone that is full of himself. He is certainly it. He's taking right after the champion who is the best at it, the nature boy, Ric Flair. JJ instills that attitude in his men, whether we like it or not.
We certainly cannot predict when a man will be pinned. Certainly every athlete has a different threshold of pain and punishment. But I think that was a big mistake on Barry's part. He may have had the match right there and neglected to do it.
Gilbert standing up. That's a credit to him. He's taking everything that Barry Windham can possibly dish out. And is still standing. He is still fighting. Windham right hand puts him down again. How much punishment can he take, for goodness sake?
Again, too long between point A and point B right there for Barry Windham, and now Windham really feeling the effect. Eddie Gilbert, he's going to take the opportunity and seize it. He's going to put him in the figure four.
He's got it locked in, too. He's got it right in the middle of the ring. He's got it locked in on the long legs of the United States champion and those strong legs of Eddie Gilbert. He's going to try to snap it if he can, and Dillon and Flair obviously concerned somewhat here at ringside, but Windham's lanky frame allows him to grasp the bottom rope, which will necessitate a break. But still, the damage has been done. Barry Windham's ever going to be the same in this match again. That figure four really felt its effect. Eddie doing the right thing, going right to the point once again. I've said that Gilbert is a wrestler's wrestler. He won't make many mistakes from here on out. He's going to work on Barry Windham. The tide has turned here. The momentum has shifted into the favor of Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert as the youngster from Lexington, Tennessee, fights back with all he has here on Superstation TBS.
Here comes
There's the champion. What a sickening maneuver this is. This is appalling. Evidently, he had seen enough. We saw him slap Eddie Gilbert on this program earlier. And now, once again, the disqualification because of Flair coming in. It'll be all over. But now Eddie Gilbert is helpless right now at the hands of Flair and Barry Windham. Gilbert had turned the corner. He had turned the corner. Momentum was in his favor. This is totally uncalled for. The champion of the world and the U.S. champion, the horseman of J.J. Dillon, double-teaming Eddie Gilbert, and it is certainly distasteful here. There's absolutely no reason whatsoever for this to occur.
Humiliation at the hands of the horseman, and I don't know what caused them to do something like that. Obviously, it was the fact that Eddie Gilbert would not go down. J.J. would not be beaten at all. As you see the world champion smiling, giving the okay sign to the U.S. champion.
J.J., you've led some very unprovoked attacks and some dastardly acts on a lot of people. This is uncalled for. How do you justify this?
I justify it because I have a very busy schedule handling all the commitments of the world heavyweight champion. I have a very busy schedule handling all the commitments of the United States heavyweight champion. And week in and week out, this so-called hot stuff Eddie Gilbert, he's coming out, issuing challenges, eating up valuable television time, and frankly, I got bigger and better things to take care of. I don't have time to mess with him. And now, from what I see, he's no longer going to be a problem, and you can just add his name to the list along with Dusty Rhodes, Bam Bam Bigelow, Lex Luger, Sting, and a bunch of other losers that we have taken care of.
This is a man that would obviously not go down at all to Barry Windham, and they're coming.
They're so arrogant that they want to talk about it. They just want to smile and gloat and walk off. Fans, Magnum TA will be talking to the American Dream Dusty Rhodes when we come back.
Barry Windham is 1989. Mr. J.J. Dillon is 1989.
Steve, and Lord, Dr. Death Williams,
I need some relief, baby. And the relief I'm going to get is taking care of business. And that is getting just a little bit nasty. And like a man said out here, letting them little devil horns get on the top of my head. Because when you are bad as Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, when you are the Bull of the Woods, when you are the National Wrestling Alliance, when you are professional wrestling, when you have been World's Heavyweight Champion three times, no punk kid that I raised from a child is going to come and take away the United States title from Dusty Rhodes in 1989. I think we ought to send all of our women jobs to Georgia and let them learn how to smile. You know what I'm talking about. Because Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, now then is pumped. And when he's pumped, there is nobody, nowhere, not even them old Bad Road Warriors. Or that World's Heavyweight Champion, Nature Boy Ric Flair. Or the Four Horsemen is only two now. Only two now. Barry Windham, as I said in the past, pay somebody. Get emotional about it. My money comes on the table every Wednesday. And that money is in the lines of a lot of love and affection across this country. And I'm going to take the United States Heavyweight title and put it back around my waist. And that's a fact. Whiskey Benton Hellbound Tour, 1989.
Michael P.S. Hayes, the Freebird, is here. I got Paul Lee, and you can see him standing up because he's home right here in Atlanta, GA, as he would say. Last house on the left. Bad Street in Atlanta, GA. That lyric has echoed through arenas all over the world. He is back indeed. Has called Atlanta, Georgia home for many, many years. Michael P.S. Hayes and Paul Lee here on Superstation TBS.
Very quickly, fans, we've seen a great match already and still to come during this two-hour program. Rick Steiner defends a world TV title in a return match against Mike Rotunda. What an event that's going to be. And still many great stars prior to that.
Moonwalking Michael P.S. Hayes. Michael Hayes is headline event all over the world. Fabulous Freebirds, a name synonymous with controversy in the world of professional wrestling, but also synonymous with the word winner, because Michael Hayes has got a great one-loss record, and he's won them in every shape, form, or fashion. He's won them in the bleachers and the cheap seats, and a lot of them, obviously, right there in the middle of the ring in the squared circle. Young Stephen Casey from the Metroplex in Dallas will be in this young man's hometown tomorrow night. He's one of the great young rookies that will be competing here in the NWA.
We'll be seeing more Stephen Casey in the weeks to come right here on TBS. You know, Michael Hayes, you mentioned about fighting in the bleachers or wherever it takes. He's never really, as he would say, walked that straight and narrow path his entire life. But one thing fans have always known about Michael Hayes, when you're in a fight with him, you're in a real scuffle.
Hayes is one of the most intense competitors that we have seen in quite some time in this modern era of professional wrestling. Michael Hayes, that glazed over look in his eye, sometimes it makes you wonder just what goes on in his mind. And we will be speaking with him and his new tag team partner, Cole Spinebuster, later in this segment. That's going to be quite interesting, I feel.
Quite a move right there. Paul Lee at his head, completely over on the other side of Michael Hayes, and he swept him over for that spine buster. Certainly Michael Hayes having his way with Paul Lee, much more experience.
Michael really excited about being back here in the NWA, and especially here in the great state of Georgia. Michael will be in Macon, Georgia this Monday night, and in Savannah this Tuesday night for great NWA action here in the Peach State. High elbow right to the chest of young Paul Lee, who's getting introduced to Freebird Michael Hayes quite aggressively here in the studios of Superstation TBS.
Really knows how to rally that crowd around him as Teddy Long checks in once again. You know, you talked about the Junkyard Dog and Michael Hayes' newfound partner. These two men know each other quite well. Certainly, they come from entirely different backgrounds, but they've made it very good tag team the last couple of weeks.
They certainly have, both men great single competitors as well. Paul Lee, well, he's trying to mount some offense. It's just not working. Junkyard Dog this Friday night will be in St. Louis to go for the gold against the Nature Boy. We'll talk to him about that. And Michael Hayes sets deep for the DDT. Face first, nowhere to go but to the showers for young Paul Lee.
Tell you what, a variety of moves for Michael Hayes. Great execution. Certainly very popular with the fans. We're going to take a look once again at Michael P.S. Hayes and the DDT right on the face. Your winner is Michael P.S. Hayes on World Championship Wrestling. And right now, he's going to ringside because Jim Ross standing by with a winner and his newfound partner.
Thank you very much, Tony Schiavone. Indeed, a very exciting team in the making here. Michael P.S. Hayes and a Junkyard Dog. We talked about the dog, but he will be in St. Louis this Friday night to go for the big money. And Nature Boy Ric Flair.
You said down in the valley deep, there sat a bad monkey sitting at the dog's feet. But every dog needs a bone to chew on, and I have found myself a bigger, bigger bone. But the thing that's beating my mind more than anything else is the United States Heavyweight Tag Team Championship around the devil's waist, and that mean, nasty Steve, Dr. Death Waves. But Hayes, somebody got to fly.
Talk to him, dog. Guess what? Trouble's back in town, baby. That's right. Michael P.S. Hayes, the showstopper. Nothing sexier, nothing higher. And I'm back, and people are wondering, why would the dog and Michael Hayes team up? They set attendance records with the most brutal feud ever in the South.
Well, that's for us to find out, because we already know that's how you're going to find out. And understand this, that Dr. Death is a big, bad machine. But machine is the key word here, because a machine cannot adapt, and it cannot change a game plan. That's why you run by that evil mind, Kevin Sullivan. But you look in these eyes right here, Jack, you ain't looking at no choir boy. But you remember this. When you talk about dogs, you talk about PS, heaven don't want us, and hell's afraid we'll take over. Now, right now you've got the United States title. It doesn't mean we don't want the World Tag Team title, but we ain't going nowhere. I'm perched with the dog right here at home in Atlanta, Georgia. I am the Freebird, and this is the dog. And like I said, on the day I was born, the nurses all gathered round.
What is it?
They gazed in wild wonder, and the joy they had found.
Yeah.
The head nurse spoke up.
Yeah.
She said, leave that one alone.
No,
she could tell right then, I was bad to the bone.
Yeah. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back right after. Tag Team Champions Kevin Sullivan and Dr. Death Steve Williams and Mike Rotunda, also of course of the Varsity Club. And Mike Rotunda certainly with a big event coming up later on against Rick Steiner, the rematch right here today on Superstation TBS. Kevin Sullivan, one of the most physically intense competitors in the sport today, tagging in the machine, as Michael Hayes and Doc and Junkyard Dog called him. Doc just caught him in midair. And that is a very brutal version of a pile driver. He caught him in midair like he would catch a blocking dummy on a gridiron.
Good fluid tag team movement, and there is the butterfly suplex. Locking both arms, bringing him right over. I tell you, you know, Kevin Sullivan and Dr. Death had not teamed together for any lengthy period of time. Came right out, won the U.S. Tag Team belts, and looking great here.
Very hard-fought victory over the Fantastics at Starrcade. Of course, the Fantastics, they're still very, very viable contenders to regain their United States titles. They've done it before. Fulton and Rogers are a great team. But as we look at this team and look at them, there's Rotunda with a water bottle. Williams coming off the second rope. It's going to take one heck of a tag team combination to match up physically. And with a brutal attitude that Williams and Sullivan possess. And here comes Randy Hogan to the slaughter. Welcome to the party as he is thrown for the ride. And Williams catches him with a clothesline.
Get it all rolled into one with Steve Williams. You've got speed and you've got power and intensity. And we all know about the change of Dr. Death. And I really think personally, Jim, that he's gotten a lot better since he's hooked up with Kevin Sullivan.
He has yet to, well, I think we have yet to see his best days in the squared circle. He is one of the toughest men on earth, in the opinion of most wrestling insiders. And the conference, Paul Sullivan. And what can you say about him? He is still maniacal. He is so unpredictable. You got to think that he's got, I'd hate to see his, a test of his competency. Mental competency, not physical. He is a very demented, sick individual.
I think this is going to send a message out to all tag teams, challengers for the U.S. Tag Team title. They're not going to wrestle defensively, I don't think, in defense of the title. They're going to be a very much an offensive team. In other words, it's very tough, Jim, as you know, for a challenger to win, because you must beat the champion. But for challengers, going to find himself being beaten also from this offensive-minded team we're seeing of Kevin Sullivan and Dr. Death.
I don't care who's in there with Williams and Sullivan. They're going to be in for a very, very physical battle. A battle that's going to take its physical toll, perhaps like no other, as Sullivan wants some more of the youngster Mark Collins. And he hammers him as he comes through the rope. Kevin Sullivan has been involved in some of the most controversial incidents in the sport. And now, as one half of the United States Tag Team Champion, I think he's even more dangerous. And this is a brutal move right here, Tony.
Absolutely at his mercy. Mike Collins tied up, and he's going to do it one more time. Nothing Mike Collins could do, as Sullivan now, for the third time, will go right to the ribcage.
They have no regard whatsoever for their opponents. They have no compassion, no sympathy at all. They are here to hurt people, to break people apart. This is a great tag team combination. And as I mentioned earlier, Tony, it's going to take a heck of a team to stay in the ring with them. And I know they've got to have their sights set on any piece of gold out there. And here comes the Oklahoma Stampede. As powerful a slam as there is in the sport. Dr. Death Steve Williams and Kevin Sullivan completely annihilating this young team. And Tony Schiavone prepares to talk to the varsity club. And we'll take another look at the Oklahoma Stampede. Look at the heights he gets and look at the impact. There's nothing like it in the sport. The Stampede, the U.S. champion, victorious, and Tony Schiavone is standing by with the varsity club.
What's that say?
That says varsity club. I tell you what, the Oklahoma Stampede, just a mere formality. That match was over from the word go. This team is looking awesome as ever. I know it's a big day for him later on going after Rick Steiner.
This is it, 1989. It's the varsity club's year. I can smell excitement in the air. First of all, new United States tag team champions. And we're going to be fighting champions. Hawk. Hawk. Road Warrior Hawk and Road Warrior. Well, I just have to tell you, you're always talking. And you're talking hard. And you scare a lot of people when you talk. What do you say? You like to snatch on danger and die on death? Well, here's danger right here. And here's death right there. And you'll choke on this. You want to be fighting champions right now. We want you any place, any time, anywhere, Road Warriors. You ain't the bullies of the block. The Varsity Club are. Tell them, Michael.
I'll tell you what, let me say something right here about Rick Steiner. The man certainly is on a hot streak right now, and as you know, momentum's a big part of this sport.
But it's a short-lived hot streak, because Steiner's nothing more than a moron.
Moron!
Steiner, what does it feel like to be a kleptomaniac moron?
Kleptomaniac moron!
You're so stupid you stole the belt and you don't even know it! And today, I'm gonna leave you laying, Steiner, because that belt's mine, I worked hard for it, and you're a thief and you stole it!
Man, there's been an challenge issued to the Road Warriors from the Varsity Club. We'll see the Road Warriors, talk to them later on. Don't forget Rick Steiner, Michael Turner for the World TV title. But right now, coming up, NWA Action, brought to you by Old Spice. Now the Road Warriors are here with Force, the World Tag Team Champions. And you talk about destruction. We've said it all along about the Road Warriors, but even more so now, Paul Ellering comes out with him. He's a real bad apple. They're just three bad apples.
The Road Warriors, the World Tag Team Champions, they are so awesome. There's Animal, over 300 pounds. Dale LaPerouse has got to be a 6'3 or 6'4, and he's just been annihilated. He's just been cut down. Here comes the clothesline from the top. Mike. Man, he may need some medical attention here. The Road Warriors are so awesome. The World Tag Team Champions. They may have the worst attitude in the sport today, all led by their arrogant manager, Paul Ellering. And we'll take another look at this situation. This is simply breathtaking. The impact. And the result. Another victory for the World Tag Team Champions, the Road Warriors. Fans, this man needs medical attention. Tony, take it away, will you please?
All right, Jim Ross, I will. They're getting a stretcher into the ring right there, as you can see, for Dale LaPerouse, who certainly has not been to do much of anything else. Maybe not only the remainder of the day, but also the entire weekend. Want to talk to the World Tag Team Champions. As you know, gentlemen, the number one contenders, always the U.S. Tag Team Champions. I'm sure you heard Kevin Sullivan out here issuing a challenge to you gentlemen to put up these belts.
Tony Schiavone, Kevin Sullivan, Steve Williams, you gotta be kidding me. I think you're joking. I don't think you even got the nerve to sign a contract. Tell him, Hawk. Tony Schiavone! You know, you don't gotta be crazy to wrestle, but it sure helps a lot. But in your case, Kevin Sullivan, crazy's not gonna help you. It's gonna be a deterrent. Something bad for you, something good for us. Because when we're done, we'll snack on Sullivan, we'll dine on Duck, and dead men will never have made money. Tell them, Animal.
Now stop talking about it. What do I think we've got going on here? Like I said before, in the United States, we didn't seem to be able to trust anybody. Our other partner went disinfectionary with a sibling breath, and he wasn't there to defend our six-man title. The other guy had a hog all the action, come in here, show everybody he's a big superstar. That happened in the United States. We went to Japan, and we found the biggest, baddest partner we could find to be our six-man champion, and his name is Tenryu, one of the most feared men in Japan. One thing the Japanese are known for is their respect and their loyalty. And if he's going to be loyal to us, he's going to kick butt with our talent, huh?
Gracious Paul, manager of managers, what do you got to say to Kevin Sullivan?
Well, Hawk, I think Kevin Sullivan provides for everybody a unique perspective on the human condition. That's what you do, Kevin Sullivan. You are an indignant slob, a pugnacious infidel, and you opened your big mouth, and you better keep it shut.
And he's dumb, too.
Got an announcement here that Tenryu teaming up with the Road Warriors to become the World Six-Man Champ. Still to come in our second hour, Mike Rotunda and Rick Snyder for the World TV title. Don't you dare go away. We're back here, ladies and gentlemen. I got to say right now that what you did was so disgusting and very, very unbecoming of a champion.
Yeah, what I did is go out there and have the best match possible with what I had in the ring. Now, if you don't like that, that's tough. Because what I did is start cage. I went out and did what I said. I beat Bam Bam Bigelow. I said I was going to go out here and beat Eddie Gilbert, and that's exactly what I did, right, Chip?
But why did you get in the ring, may I ask, please?
You know, I can't figure out either. I'm wearing a $1,200 silk custom-made suit. Why did I get in the ring? Because I'm in that frame of mind. You know what? It's a new year. It's a new year for Ted Turner. It's a new year for the National Wrestling Alliance. And that means, woo, it's a new year for the champions in this great sport. And for the mastermind that makes it go round and round, we're going to make this the biggest and best year ever for the Four Horsemen, whether you like it or can't.
Let me handle this. What's your problem?
I just want to say this first. If you're around for 101, I respect that. You're the world heavyweight champion. You're the U.S. heavyweight champion. You guys want to fight 201? That's when I got to go call somebody. And I went and called somebody, and I've already discussed this with the Turner people. I've already discussed this with Mr. Crockett's people. And I just want to ask you to do one thing for me, sir. I want you to just look at one of these cameras and agree that next week, right here on the Superstation, you and you, with you, will wrestle me and my partner that I just made a phone call.
You've got a lot of nerve. You've either got to be awful tough or awful stupid. And I saw you earlier today, and you didn't look so tough. And you got to be awful stupid to walk out. That's the world heavyweight champion, United States champion. Now, you tell me you already called somebody?
But I've already got them. It's lined up. All you've got to do is say yes.
And there's somebody willing to jump into your mess kit with what you already got involved in.
My partner.
You want to wrestle us?
Yeah,
right there.
Who you got?
We already beat him.
Loser's out.
We've already established
and the Road Warriors are our friends.
And Batman Bigelow, he just kicked his tip.
You got somebody.
I got somebody. All you got to do is say yes. Y'all are so
confident.
It's like a great night.
I'm going to be honest with you. I'm sick and tired of looking at you, okay? I'm really sick and tired of looking at you. And I got more important things to do. So I will give you a verbal commitment. You talk about next week. I'll give you a verbal commitment next week. Anybody you want except Luger, and you got your match.
Right.
And maybe we'll see the last of you, finally.
Thank you. You guys are for the biggest surprise of your life.
Well, I hope that you'll keep your word. I hope that you'll look in the camera and keep your word this time.
Who can he possibly get? You think I look worried? Eddie Gilbert. Who would even have...
Well, I hope that we take this seriously. You're not taking this seriously at all, are you?
I'll tell you what. You know, for a moment, there was a little humorous injection into this whole thing. But the bottom line is, anybody that's fool enough to walk out here in getting my face and getting Barry Windham's face after what we just did to him is a real man. And I'm going to give you a due, Gilbert. You're man enough to bring somebody out here next week. You got the match. Plan on it. But this time, you and your partner won't walk out of that ring. Bet on it.
No holds barred, right?
Ladies and gentlemen, there you hear. We'll talk more about that in the program. And now let's go up to Paul E. Dangerously.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's the team that backs up every single word I say. Loverboy Dennis and Ravishing Randy, the Midnight Express!
I'll tell you something, what else can happen in this program? We've got the World Television Championship match still to come. And then next week, Larry Greenjoy, Barry Windham, James J. Dillon, Eddie Gilbert was very confident leaving the podium there, Jim Ross. Eddie Gilbert had a smile on his face for the first time in several weeks as he walked out of here. The fans at us next week. Also, I want to let you know, as we take a look at the original Midnight Express, we heard the Road Warriors talk about Tenru, their six-man champion. Our first chance to see Tenru in action as part of the World Six-Man Champions will be here on the Superstation Wednesday, February 15th on Clash of Champions 5, live from Cleveland. That's at 8:05 Eastern Time, Wednesday night, February 15th. And that will be quite a situation. We'll try to find out their opponents a little bit later in the hour.
Okay.
We will make that announcement and hear someone, I'm sure, is just dying to say something.
You know, I was just watching what happened with Eddie Gilbert, and, you know, he made a phone call, and it wasn't to me, so I'm not going to be Eddie Gilbert's partner, so I wonder who it's going to be.
I'm sure they're relieved of that.
But another observation I have to make is, hey, Michael Hayes is back in the NWA. And the thing is, does Michael Hayes pay George Thorogood a royalty for every interview that he does?
Does the term babbling fool come to your mind when he gets around? He just gets under my skin. He's taking some skin from Jim Cornette, and we're not talking high fives here. We're talking off his body. Certainly a man who feels that he has everything going his way right now, but the fact remains, and the point was brought up certainly at the start gate, that the battle was won that night in the ring, but the war was far from being over. Tony, we're going to show a piece of videotape that I think the fans are going to find most interesting regarding the Midnight versus Midnight situation. And after looking at it, I think many of the fans will probably agree that that man with the telephone may have the upper hand at this point in time. Boy, in that ring, he has got a well-oiled machine. Randy Rose and Dennis Condrey, I mean, are two of the finest-tuned athletes, tag team specialists. There's a dropkick. Randy Rose, the dropkick right off the top rope. We have not seen that move before from those two men.
Not at all, but when you go in a battle against beautiful Bobby Sweet Stan, you've really got to fight fire with fire, as the old cliche goes. You have to adapt to their style.
Go right at them with what their strong suit is. Always talking, he's always got something to say, and we'll be speaking with him at length in a few moments. That's the bad news. At length is the part I'm talking about. And when we do, we're going to show exactly what happened to Jim Cornette when Jim Cornette was at ringside with the Fantastics, I understand. Dennis Condrey buries the knee to Trent Knight. Dennis Condrey and Bobby Eaton at one time were perhaps the highest rated tag team in the entire sport of professional wrestling. Nice drop toe hold, followed by a great team move. Drops the leg right on the back of the head of Trent Knight. But that friendship and allegiance between Eaton and Condrey has really dissolved and disintegrated.
By the way, you know, I just wanted to make this point. Everybody just named Dennis Condrey the lover boy. It was Jim Cornette's mama. She had personal experience.
Oh, get out of here. Well, let's go back to the ring. That last move we saw executed, very similar to the move that Bobby and Stan used, where Bobby comes off the rope to the elbow. That time, after the leg takedown, it was Randy Rose with a leg drop off of the rope. Great team wrestling. They do things as one. Both men wrestling as one, and Bob Emmerich can barely even stand up, and kind of just goes down to his level and clotheslines him anyway. say what we can say about Loverboy Dennis Condrey, not necessarily about the name, but about the man in the ring. Truly one of the most sadistic men we've ever had here on the NWA. Another great double team move here. A lot of double team moves. This is a tag team specialist. These two men are really operating the human cough drop. All right. Jim Ross going over to talk to Paulie Dangerously. And here is the move that ended the match for the original. That's called the human cough drop. Once again, the human cough drop.
Right, you're going to go back to delivering pizzas.
Man, Jim Ross will talk to Paulie Dangerously right after this. Back here with Paulie Dangerously and the original Midnight Express. And quite obviously, I would assume that because of recent developments, that is the reason you're so happy, almost to the point of being a little
Tommy
crazy.
Tommy Edwards is the producer of this show and the director of this show, and he has a film. Tommy, I watched the monitor right here. Play the film so everybody at home can see what we did. I'm looking at the monitor. Here it is. Now watch what happens. You see, Jim Cornette is such a fool, he thinks that he's going to get his hands up Paulie Dangerously, and my two men are going to let him do it. But watch what happens when you mess with Loverboy Dennison Ravishing Randy. Watch what happens when you play one-upmanship with the Midnight Express. That's what happens, Jim Cornette, just like you did a couple of years ago to a broad whose name I ain't going to mention on national television. I did it to you again. Everything you've done, I can do better, Jimmy.
You see, I won up on you, man.
You said that nobody could take the name of the Midnight Express, and everybody recognizes Loverboy Dennison Ravishing Randy. That's the Midnight Express. You came out here for years with a tennis racket, and you say you're the best manager in the business, and now all the magazines say that I'm the best manager in the business. You see, Jimmy, the score is 1-0. But let's get the record straight right now. You're still in the NWA. You're still coming out here on national television. You're still running your yapper like your mama never taught you to shut up.
But let me tell you something. I'm not going to come out here and say, Jimmy Cornette, that I'm going to put you in a grave because that's taking things a little too far. But I will tell you this.
When it comes to careers, I'm obsessed with your demise, and one of us has got to go because this town ain't big enough for the both of us, my man. So when it comes to careers, you think it's over when I leave. And I think it's over when I sit on your career's grave. You're out of the NWA. I promise you.
All right, fans, we'll talk to Jim Cornette and see his team in action. But right now, let's go back up to the ring. All right, thanks a lot, Jim Ross. Larry Zbyszko, Al Perez with Gary Hart against George South and Curtis Thompson. The Western States champion, Zbyszko, and the Latin heartthrob, Al Perez, along with Gary Hart at ringside. Well, there's Abdullah the Butcher, along with Gary Hart. Abdullah the Butcher, one of them, what a complex, dangerous, sadistic individual he is. And thankfully, he's being banished from ringside. I feel much more secure about our position now that he is gone.
I'm sure everyone in the studio feels the same way. Nothing is safe when Abdullah the Butcher is around. And, you know, the same thing can be said for the guys in the ring, because Zbyszko and Perez are fine wrestlers. There's been a lot of talk about these two men going after Ric Flair individually for the NWA World Heavyweight title. We'll talk to Gary Hart about that a little bit later on.
I find that most interesting. Larry Zbyszko won the Western States Championship on January 24th of 1988. He's been the Western States champion almost 1 year. And the Latin sensation Al Perez, since he came to the NWA with Gary Hart in the middle part of the year, has amassed one of the greatest one-loss records in the sport. But in the same breath, how many title shots do you remember Al Perez getting? You know, the rumors circulate, as you know, the NWA, there comes the Butcher. The rumors circulate in the NWA all the time. And I'm going to address as George South is getting hijacked here. What has he got? Looks like a coat hanger or a noose or something, pulling Abdullah Butcher back out of the way.
He is a wild man, completely out of control. Hart's got to get him in a cage or shackles or something. Get him out of here, please.
And Al Perez, as we were talking about, you talk about going from the the beast to the beauty. Al Perez is a great athlete, as we have talked about on many occasions, and I think he or Zbyszko at any time would be viable contenders for the World's Heavyweight Championship. Zbyszko and Flair, both basically the same experience. One was Rookie of the Year in 1 year, and the very next year, it was Larry Zbyszko. He got his shoulder up. That was obvious. Zbyszko will be the man to tell you that he has prided himself in his career at ending legends. 14 glorious years.
Thank you.
That retiring some of the greatest names in our sport. Allegedly, Larry Zbyszko was the man to put a lot of the guys out, and he claims that Ric Flair will be another one of these. He knows how to wrestle the big match. There's no doubt about that. But I think Al Perez has got some of the greatest untapped potential. I don't agree with their philosophy because who could? There's the alley copter, and it works to perfection. George South has really been decimated here by these two men. We'll take another look here, fans, in slow motion of the closing moments of this tag team encounter before Tony Schiavone talks with Gary Hart about the situation of the world title. There's the alley copter. Zbyszko and Perez with another victory. Resoundingly so, they're looking for bigger and better things, and we will talk with them right after you see this on how you can order the video, Starrcade 88.
True Grit. True Grit. True Grit. It's a competition in a class by itself. Starrcade 88. True Grit. The biggest, baddest wrestling event of the year. Now available on video cassette. Witness over 2 hours of thrilling, heart-stopping action. It's an eye for an eye when American Dream Dusty Rhodes and sizzling hot Sting battle against the awesome might of the Road Warriors. And massive Bam Bam Bigelow gets his shot at the U.S. heavyweight title and the self-confident Barry Windham. Plus, dog-faced gremlin Rick Steiner struggles for his honor and the World TV title against former teammate Mike Rotunda. The Midnight Express with Jim Cornette and the original Midnight Express with Paul E. Dangerously fight for supremacy in a raging grudge match. And Steve, Dr. Death Williams, tags up with Games Master Kevin Sullivan in an intense duel with the Fantastics for the U.S. Tag Team Championship. And the ultimate five-time World Heavyweight Champion Nature Boy Ric Flair collides with Total Package Lex Luger in a powerful NWA World Heavyweight Championship matchup that may never again be repeated. Plus, much, much more. You won't want to miss a minute of this historic first-class competition. Starrcade 88 True Grit. Reserve your ringside seat by ordering this action-packed video cassette today. Here's how to order.
To order your very own Starrcade 88 True Grit video cassette, get your credit card ready and call toll-free 1-800-257-1234 or send $30 plus $5 postage and handling to Starrcade 88, Box 7500, Atlanta, Georgia. Sorry, no CODs. Operators are standing by now, so call 1-800-257-1234.
Tell you what, it had to be very difficult for Gary Hart. Not only did he have to pay attention to the match, but had to control the Bill the Butcher a couple times. But I want to ask you a question. Rumors circulate, as you know, in the NWA all the time, and these two men certainly worthy of going after Ric Flair in the World Heavyweight title. The scuttlebutt is that they have put pressure on you because of your close alliance to James J. Dillon to break that off and sign world title matches for them. Did they put pressure on you?
They put tremendous pressure. I believe they've got every right to put that pressure. I was letting them down. I wasn't going after you, Ricky, because of my association with Jimmy Dillon. Now, I want to make it perfectly clear. I have the utmost respect for you as a wrestling champion. I think that you are probably, without a doubt, the greatest champion to ever wear the NWA title. You have held that belt five different times. But now it's time, Ricky, to try for six. Because let me tell you something. Al Perez is the greatest piece of work that has come along in the wrestling since young Ricky Flair. You talk about yourself being a 60-minute man. Well, if that's true, he's a 90-minute man. You have wrestled some great people, and you have gotten by. But let me tell you something, Flair, and let me tell you something, J.J. Dillon. If you get your nose in the match that's coming up in Florida with Al Perez against you, Ricky Flair, I promise you, Dillon,
you will receive a personal visit from none other than the chief boogeyman, Abdullah himself, the butcher. So if you want to play in my ballpark, Dylan, you're in a lot of trouble. You have wrestled the best. You think. Now you're going to get the best. Perez and Sabisco.
Yeah, let me just say something quick. Because 1980, I retired one legend. 1987, I retired another legend. And Flair, you're the one that I want to retire the most. Because you're just like I am. You're the cream of the crop like I am. We're the best of the best. And in 1989, 14 glorious years, Giovanni, Larry Zbyszko's going to be the heavyweight champion of the world.
All right, fans, Dick Murdoch still to come and more action right after this timeout. Champion Redneck Dick Murdoch against Eddie Sweat in this next event on World Championship Wrestling, and still to come during this hour, a World TV title rematch, Rick Steiner against Mike Rotunda. Fans, don't you dare go away.
Talk starting off very quickly against Eddie Sweat here on the Superstation. Dick Murdoch on that massive card tomorrow night at the State Fair Coliseum in Dallas. All our fans in the Metroplex. And Dick Murdoch will be there. Perhaps his son, a member of the South Lake Carroll Dragons. Murdoch, anything that's not nailed down is apt to be used with Murdoch around. I was going to say, Dick Murdoch's son Brandon played on the South Lake Carroll Dragons football team this year. They're in the Metroplex. They went 16-0, Tony. 3A state champions in the state of Texas. I know Dick's real proud of his son and all those outstanding young athletes. I'm sure we'll see some of them tomorrow night in the Metroplex for our big NWA event.
Well, the Metroplex always hot for NWA wrestling. We look forward to seeing all of our fans there. Dick Murdoch, you're right about anything at all that's not nailed down, or even if it's nailed down, he'll throw you up against it.
It doesn't make any difference if his opponent is 400 pounds or a 230 or 40 pounder like Eddie Sweat here. Dick Murdoch is one of the most, he's a man that can just dissect you. He has any style you want to wrestle. If you want to wrestle a scientific match, I've seen him in some of the greatest scientific matches that I've personally ever witnessed. And I've also seen him in some of the bloodiest brawls that I've ever seen. He is a man for all seasons, is Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. He can certainly, as his old saying goes, don't worry about the wagon, don't worry about the mule, just load the wagon.
Execution's been his forte, whether it be the elbow drop, or a right hand, or whether it be that brainbuster suplex. You're right about Dick Murdoch, and he is really no match at all for Eddie Sweat.
I'll tell you something else, Tony. He's also got quite a reputation up in Missouri, and the NWA will be in St. Louis, one of Murdoch's strongholds, this Friday night in St. Louis, and also a week from tonight in Kansas City. And Murdoch just is in that old cantankerous mood.
Yeah,
he was probably driving his truck last night, listening to a little George Strait. Maybe, just maybe, with a long neck or two. And, you know, he may be a little sideways here today, but he is a, what a competitor.
What an athlete.
Eddie Sweat dropped on his head by Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. And the captain, of course, in Oakland tonight, in Dallas tomorrow night, State Fair Coliseum. And we'll take another look at the old brainbuster from the captain.
Here comes Scotty Buffett over and then down on the head. Your winner, Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. And now, Missy Hyatt will talk with the world champion, Rick Flair.
I'm Missy Hyatt, and ladies and gentlemen, this is the Nature Boy, Rick Flair. And besides being sexier than Don Johnson and Sylvester Stallone combined, he is the world's heavyweight champion. Now, Rick, a lot of people are saying that at Starrcade that you cheated against Lex Luger to keep your belt, and, you know, I know that Ric Flair wouldn't cheat, now would you?
Well, Missy, you have to know from the bottom of your heart that Ric Flair is not capable of cheating. Ric Flair is not the kind of athlete that would go out in that ring and do anything but wrestle to the best of his ability.
Well, as we just saw there, you picked up a chair and you're about to hit Lex on the leg with it.
Well, Missy, let me explain something to you. In the heat of the battle, every once in a while, things get carried away. And as you can see right here, Rick has nothing in the ring illegal right now. All Ric Flair is doing is administering one of the worst beatings in the history of Lex Luger's career. And as you can see, Luger's leg just wasn't strong enough supports the massive bulk of Ric Flair.
Yeah, but I just saw you put your feet on the ropes.
On those ropes to keep my balance, that's all. Ric Flair beat Lex Luger clean as clean can be.
Well, now you're going around and telling everybody, well, I'm not going to wrestle Lex Luger anymore. And, I mean, Lex Luger's a worthy to go up against your belt.
Lex Luger is the golden Adonis. Lex Luger is the people's choice. Let's put it on the line, Missy. He's the golden Adonis. He's the man that everybody picked to dethrone Ric Flair from his World Heavyweight Wrestling Championship. But Luger, you can't style and you can't profile. You're not riding in limousines. You're not flying in jet airplanes. Then you can't have any woman in the world you want just like that, pal, because you're not Ric Flair. And I don't care what it costs me. I don't care what I got to give Ted Turner, what I've got to pay my attorneys. You have had your last match with the World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. You understand that? Sit down, grasp it. And for all you hundreds of thousands of people that thought it would happen again, it won't. It's over. Luger has had his last shot at Ric Flair. That means you will never wrestle for the world title again as long as I'm champion. Now, Missy, that isn't too hard to understand, is it? Ric Flair, Ted Turner, I'm the man that brought Moses Malone to Atlanta. I'm the greatest athlete alive. I am Missy Akiss. Stealing, wheeling, dealing, limousine riding, woo, jet flying, set up again. They call, woo, the Nature Boy.
Ladies and gentlemen, America's favorite tag team, Beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan, the Midnight Express. Jim and Stan, the true Midnight Express in the eyes of these fans, not only here in the studios of TBS, but I'm sure many of the thousands that are watching our broadcast here from Superstation TBS. I tell you, every commercial break, every match brings something new, and it's just very interesting to me that the fans have so taken to Jim Cornette and his quest to get Paul Dangerously out of the NWA. Jim Cornette knows that in the ring that these two men are as good as they come, and that includes Ravishing Randy, Loverboy Dennis.
I just had to make sure everything was all right over there. You know, as a great man once said, rumors of my demise have been greatly exaggerated. I heard that punk out here talking. Supposedly they're the real Midnight Express. The only people he's proved that to is the three of them, Rose, Condry, and Dangerously. Supposedly I'm out of professional wrestling to have you listen to him. Well, look at this right here. The Midnight Express still doing the best teamwork moves in town. Jim Cornette still mouthing off, brother, same as always. And I'm going to tell you something. I hate to admit it, but that punk is getting under my skin. That punk is getting to me, Tony, and I don't like it.
Jimmy wants to do more than that. I mean, he was saying some very threatening things about your career and your livelihood when he walked up here.
I know what Paulie Dangerously is trying to do because I've been doing the same thing for years. He's messing with my head. The only thing is, even though I know that that's what he's trying to do, he's just so obnoxious, it still bugs me. But I'm going to tell you this right now, Bobby and Stan, they have got Dennis Conrad and Randy Rose. They're going to get them under control. They're going to fix that situation, but they're going to leave Paulie Dangerously for me, brother, because the things he's done, no matter, he's like trying to stomp out a nest of cockroaches. Beautiful Bobby going up to the top rope right there, the greatest flying talent in professional wrestling. Just like trying to stomp out a nest of cockroaches. As long as Bobby and Stan are doing moves like that, Condry and Rose, they can't keep up the pace. But that Paulie Dangerously, every time you think you've got him, he manages to get the last laugh. Every time you got a victory, he manages to snatch the last word, and he's been beating my brains out. Well, let me tell you this. Like I said, Bobby and Stan said they're going to leave Paulie for me. And if it comes to a showdown, brother, I'm more than ready for him, because I've said before, I can't kick too many rear ends, but his, I know I can kick. You know that Condry is thicker than when I knew him. Dennis Condry is so thick. For bedtime stories, he reads his kids the obituaries. Do you realize that? And that Paulie Dangerously, he's not the kind of guy only a mother could love. He's the kind of guy that would cause a mother to have her tube side change her name and move to another state. That man is sick. He is a disease on professional wrestling, and we are the cure. And right there, the teamwork once again, can't nobody match it. The Midnight Express, that's why that they have stayed the best. Time after time, year after year, wrestlers have come, wrestlers have gone, tag teams have been on top. But the Midnight Express has been the standard that tag teams have been judged in the NWA, and we will continue to be, and we're going to fix this problem. And Paulie Dangerously, like I said, they're going to leave him to me, brother. And here it is. They're standing up all over America. The move they want to see, the Veg-O-Matic. It's slight and it's dicey.
You can't order that by phone, and don't try that move at home. Not at all. Keep Cyborg's right flat, supine to the ceiling. Let's take another look at this. Stan's got Steinborn set, and here comes beautiful Bobby. What a move. That is a thing of beauty. And fans will talk to Jim Cornette and show you some more videotape about his situation right after this. And it's the world title, TV title, still to come. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're back here on Superstation TBS. And earlier, I had the non-privileged speaking or listening to Paul E. Dangerously, and I want to say I try to really remain objective out here.
Well, you
but shouldn't. I can't. That subject I shouldn't.
You
He's
shouldn't.
Getting under my skin, and these people as well.
You know, they say, Jim Cornette, you're a problem child. Wish I had 5 cents for every time I heard that. From school teachers, from my relatives, from my mother, Jim Cornette, you're a problem child. Stan Lane, when he was in grade school, he got Valentine's cards from his teachers. Stan Lane was a problem child. Bob Eaton used to run around Huntsville, Alabama with a band of hoodlums till all hours of the night. Bobby Eaton was a problem child. We've always done things our way. We're hard-headed. We get it done. We do it our way, and we stay on top because we're good. But now Paulie Dangerously comes out here. He wants to play the Midnight Express game. He wants to act like a horse's rear end. I wrote a book on that a long time ago. And most of all, Paulie Dangerously wants to get rid of Jim Cornette. You got a little VTR? Go ahead and show the VTR. He can show one, I can too. Starrcade 88, we won the match, and we had the moment of glory ripped from us because that little punk, while I was trying to get a hold of him, Condry and Rose got me from behind and dusted us off real good. Paulie, you think we're back in the old West, and you're the cocky young punk that's going to come and take the old aging gunfighter and blow him away and be the new fastest gun in the West. Well, let me tell you something, Paulie. And you get this through your head. For one thing, I'm 27 years old. I ain't ready for the rest home yet. For another thing, for every one time that that cocky young punk blew that old gunfighter away and became the fastest gun in the West, there were 1,000 snotty-nosed punks that got that snotty nose blown straight off their face and got a one-way ticket to Boot Hill. And Paulie, that's what you are. You're a snotty-nosed punk managing a cheap imitation tag team that beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan are going to take care of. And Paulie, you want to show down with me, brother? You want to play the Midnight Express game with me? Well, we'll play. But just remember, I wrote the rule book, and the rules say the game ain't over until I win. They're going to take care of your team. You're up to me. And Paulie, you show down with me, you're going to turn into the shakiest gun in the West, pal.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, there you hear from Jim Cornette. As the war rages on, and now let's go up to the ring and Tony Schiavone. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a return match. One fall, 20 minutes for the NWA World Television Championship. Introducing, first of all, the challenger,
from Syracuse, New York, at 244 pounds, Mike Rotundo. Mike Rotundo. And now the NWA World Television Champion from Ann Arbor, Michigan, in at 260 pounds, here is the champion, Rick Steiner, for the title, 20 minutes.
And ladies and gentlemen, we'll have this matchup right after we come back from this very brief timeout.
It's World Championship Wrestling, the stars of the NWA, the Cobb County Civic Center in Marietta. Tuesday, January 31st, 7:30 in Marietta, Georgia. Civic Center Coliseum in Charleston, West Virginia. Sunday, January 29th, 2 p.m. in Charleston. Civic Center, Roanoke, Virginia. Thursday, January 26th, 7:30 in Roanoke. Veterans Memorial Coliseum, Jacksonville, Florida. Wednesday, January 25th, 7:30 in Jacksonville. The Ocean Center in Daytona Beach. On Tuesday, January 24th, 7:30 in Daytona Beach. The Bayfront Center in St. Petersburg. Monday, January 23rd, 7:30 with Sting, the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, others in St. Pete. Municipal Auditorium in Kansas City. Saturday, January 21st, 8 o'clock, The Road Warrior, Sting, Rick Steiner, others in Kansas City. The Q Auditorium in St. Louis. Friday, January 20th, 8 o'clock, with the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, Barry Windham, Dick Murdoch, others in St. Louis. Fairgrounds Coliseum in Dallas, Texas. Tomorrow night, 7:30, The Road Warriors, The Junkyard Dog, others tomorrow night in Dallas. And tonight, 8 o'clock in Oakland at the Kaiser Convention Center. Lex Luger, Rick Steiner, others coming tonight in Oakland.
For the World Television Championship, the champion Rick Steiner, the challenger Mike Rotundo, the rematch right here on Superstation TBS.
I hope you have your sandwiches made at home, because you don't want to leave the set. Oh, this, oh, God, what a clothesline. Boy, this is going to be physical. Rotundo challenging Steiner for the NWA Television Championship, and Rotundo goes all the way over the top.
They always talk about Steiner's lack of intellect, and I think it just proves right there that he is as smart as they come in the ring, intelligent, and he goes right at him again.
Steiner's got to be sure that he stays in the ring, because Sullivan is like a shark out here on the outside, high to the bases. Mike Rotundo up in the light, lateral press by the television champion. Our second big main event, the first one, Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert and Barry Windham. And next week here in the program, it will be Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert and a mystery partner against Nature Boy Ric Flair and Barry Windham right here next week at 7:05 Eastern Time here on the Superstation.
Fans, and don't forget, it was a very competent Eddie Gilbert that left also. Now, Rick Steiner. The man realizes, and you said it, he has to be in the ring, get away from the floor with Kevin Sullivan. You know Sullivan, especially with Steiner, is going to take his shot if he can.
Collar and elbow tie-up. Steiner, nice fireman carry takeover into the arm bar by Rick Steiner. Reversal by Rotundo. I think he may have pulled a hair there. Steiner frees himself anyway. Well, both these men's alma maters were victorious in their respective bowl games a couple of weeks ago. Syracuse and Michigan, these guys really come from quality athletic programs. They've been schooled in the art of self-defense, if you will, as Alex gives Steiner, I guess, some last-minute instructions here.
You know, Rotundo really letting this crowd bother him, and if the world television title is important as he says it is, and I know it is, he really ought to try to leave the crowd alone and think about the task at hand. You've got to have great concentration against an athlete like Steiner. If you don't, then you've lost before you've gone into it.
Steiner has become one of the most popular athletes in the NWA. That covers a lot of ground, but he certainly has done it. Side headlock for Tendencenzi for the ride. Nice football tackle by Steiner. Shows great athletic ability there. Perfectly executed hip lock by Rotundo. Steiner kicked him off as Rotundo came off. Oh! Off the rope. It chills up your spine. And Rotundo, spine chilling or not, is going to take a break for a moment. Steiner's one guy that if you let build up ahead of steam and get momentum, he can simply destroy you. He can disrupt you. And that man, Mike Rotundo, certainly knows that. Tony, we both have the utmost respect for Mike Rotundo as far as his athletic ability is concerned. But the demonic Kevin Sullivan has got that hole over Dr. Death and Rotundo. It's amazing and a little bit scary. He held on to the World Television Championship for almost a year. Spoiled in Starcade by Rick Steiner.
He's gotten his breather. You know, we always say, Jim Ross, you can't call timeout, but you can waste enough time to where, in effect, you get a timeout. That's what happened. He got his own time outside of the ring, and now he's really fighting back.
Steiner needs to be in a situation where he can react and not have to plot strategy and think. And I don't mean it totally disrespectful. Thinking's not his big forte. He's a man's man. He's a wrestling machine. He's an instinctive athlete. But right now, Rotunda, he slows the pace up, he picks it up, he slows it down, and it's confusing Steiner somewhat as Rotunda buries the fist right to the face of the former All-American from Michigan, and he's thrown out here. This is the dangerous area for him right here, with Sullivan circling like a shark, a great white. Gosh, almighty!
That was a block of wood.
Wood box or something.
A wood box that they used to... I have no idea what they use it for, but Steiner was nailed again. This is where the danger comes. Did he hit that camera? It may have hit the pedestal over there. I'm not sure.
Got kicked right in the face. We do know that conclusively. Alex is really, I guess, having to really come up with some strategy for Steiner here.
I don't know if it's strategy or just motivation right now. Tell him, get back on your feet. That, in fact, what he said, right to a sleeper hold. And now, Sullivan thinks it's all over. He thinks victory is at hand, and he thinks the Varsity Club will add another belt to their collection.
Of course, Sullivan and Dr. Death, United States Tag Team Champions. Rotunda using the ropes for leverage. He's got the neck cramp. Look at the Steiner, the angle that his neck is in. He's cutting off the blood supply, slowing it down, restricting it. The blood supply to the brain. He can certainly lose consciousness here very, very easily. As just about everybody in the house can see that Rotunda was using the ropes for that additional leverage. Of course, it's illegal, but Teddy Long, gosh, what a kisser that is.
Yeah, that's a kisser, but you know, it's an entirely different look on that kisser. That is a definite look of concern on Kevin Sullivan, one that I haven't seen in a long time.
Maybe like Geraldo did, especially with Charles Manson, maybe he should do one with Kevin Sullivan. Gosh almighty, what a clothesline.
The key to the clothesline is not executing it per se. It's knowing when to execute it. And he timed that one perfectly at the right time. After the sleeper hold, after the reverse chin lock, he nailed him with it and still has the upper hand.
Man, we've seen some physical blows in this one. Nice reversal by Steiner, but he did not get to execute his offensive move. It was Rotunda that came off the ropes with that big forearm and right to Steiner's face. He follows it up with a scoop slam and a hard one to boot. Now, this is uncharacteristic of Mike Rotunda right here. He's known as a mat wrestler. He's not a dropkick artist. This is not his forte up here, and he's waiting around.
That's right. Compound that. With the time he wasted, and now look at Steiner, swinging him down to the mat. Steiner now gets the advantage because of the procrastination by the former champion, Mike Rotunda.
Set. Nice football tackle by Steiner. He was an all-stater in high school, as was Rotunda, football and wrestling. Sullivan tries to pull the ropes down. The ropes caught Steiner right across the kidney area, but here's karate chop right to the throat. Sullivan buried the extended fingers into the throat of Rick Steiner. Steiner may have a hard time, Tony, now recuperating from this. The Charles Manson-like glare, that gleam of Kevin Sullivan.
No remorse, no guilt in that look at all, and he really jabbed him in the throat with it. Well, Rotunda doing the right thing, keeping the pressure on, outside in, suplex, well executed. You're right about being a mat wrestler, and if it can keep him down, it's where Rotunda is at his best.
This match fans for the World Television Championship, the big rematch from Starrcade 88 in Norfolk, Virginia. Steiner goes for the ride, and Rotunda catches him once again with a high-impact maneuver, the elbow right to the chest. He's got the leg grapevine, but he cannot hold him down yet.
Sullivan is worried about the influence of Alex, and now they're biting the hand. They're biting Alex in effect, I guess, right here.
Steiner's a very simple guy. He's got his dog and he's got Alex. And that's just about all he's got in this world. And he's not complaining about it. A simple man with simple means. Side stall, coast suplex. And he really planted him here.
He doesn't have the leg great, Brian. You saw that he hesitated a little bit, reaching back with the right hand. And Alex is, I guess, gosh, what are we saying? Alex is talking to Steiner? I guess he is. I don't know, man. Somebody's talking to him and telling the right things because he's the defending television champion. And it's all the gold on the line right here on Superstation TBS. Steiner goes for the ride. Sunset flip. He got poked in the eye as he's trying to take him over. This could be it right here, too. Two count.
Does not want to slug it out with Steiner, does Rotunda. And Sullivan is more concerned with Alex right now than he is with anything else about Rick Steiner. He wanted him to go after Alex again. It appears there's a standing clothesline once again, but Steiner's dazed also.
This match is taking its physical toll. Here's Dr. Death. You talk about a physical toll. It is broken loose. Teddy Long goes down at the hands of Kevin Sullivan. They're kicking the television champion. The bell is sounding for the disqualification, but they're trying to annihilate this young man. What are they going to do here? Both Sullivan and Williams on the second rope.
Pile driver type maneuver, it appears here.
Double step pile driver looks to be coming up. They just drove his head and shoulders into the mat. He's lying there limp. Look at Sullivan. Sullivan's getting the dog. Sullivan's pulling that little tooth right out of here. The dog doesn't want to go. He's dragging it. Look at the dog. They're trying to steal this dog. But wait a minute. There's a big dog right here. Right there. And Michael Hayes. Sullivan tried to steal the dog of all the low down things that Sullivan tried to do. I mean, what significance would that be? That's his best, that's Steiner's best friend right there.
Who knows what goes on in the deranged mind of Kevin Sullivan. The fact remains that they really got to Rick Steiner here with a double stacked up pile driver, nailed him, and then tried to steal the dog, and saved for these two men. Hayes and Junkyard Dog fans, we'll be right back.
The total package in the Stinger here on Superstation TBS. And fans, we must remind you that here next week, the big matchup, Nature Boy Ric Flair and Barry Windham will meet Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert and a mystery partner. And Tony, the look on Eddie Gilbert's face was very pleasant. I can't wait to see who he's going to bring out here as Bill Holiday and Agent Steele tried to take the early advantage on that man. The total package, Lex Luger, these little youngsters here in the studio look on in amazement at the physical abilities and the physical prowess of these two men seeing in the total package. Look at that.
You know, regardless of if you take a look at 1988, take a look back, it was a great year for these two men. Regardless of not having a title belt, they won the Jim Crockett Senior Memorial Cup, and I can only believe that in 89 it's going to get even better for them, especially as a team together. Great teams out there, Jim, the NWA, no denying that. These two men, not full of excitement and ability.
Ric Flair with the audacity to attempt to dictate basically the career of Lex Luger by saying that he'll never wrestle Luger again. We'll speak with Luger about that situation. Whoa, what a slam. You know, Luger has not, I've talked with him on many occasions, he has not once cried, as the old expression would go, over spilt milk. He has not whined about the match. He is an athlete. He's a competitor. That match was just another notch of experience. He's been in the sport 3 years.
Yeah, it just shows you how long, how far he has come. Not only as an athlete in the ring, he always had the looks. But we're talking about in the ring, not only as an athlete, but maturity. He's really matured over the last year. And I think those matches against Ric Flair, we go back to Baltimore, the match at Starrcade, did a lot for Lex Luger, even though he didn't come out with the title.
To think about what these two men, Sting and Luger, have accomplished the first 3 years of their career is simply amazing. Luger's been a United States champion. He's been one half of the World Tag Team champion. He and Sting have taken the world champion, Ric Flair, to the absolute limit. And they won $1 million in 1988 as the winners of the Jim Crockett Senior Memorial Cup Tag Team Tournament. I think it's in their destiny to be. They may dictate this man, and the Stinger just might dictate the course the NWA will follow in years to come.
reverse chin lock as Luger with those massive arms wrapped around the head of the masked man, Agent Steel. But I was talking about that man and his attitude. It's great. Luger's attitude is phenomenal. They just want to compete. They want to try to be the best that they can be. And I'm not, that's no commercial for the Army. These guys have been great athletes their entire careers before they ever dreamed of being in professional wrestling. The intensity that is Lex Luger and the athlete that has evolved over the past year, Lex Luger, who in one night at Starrcade came from just the total package to the complete athlete.
You know, Tony, he achieved a great deal of success in Florida, and the NWA will be back in Florida, in St. Petersburg, in Daytona Beach, also in Jacksonville in the upcoming weeks. Staying with, boy, he just powers him up. You talk about just muscling somebody up and controlling them. I don't care if it's Dr. Death and Sullivan, if it's the Road Warriors, tag teams or single competition. These guys are just, I don't know how you could get any better a team than Luger and Sting. And again, as we talk about team situations, and Bill Holliday's not having a lot of fun right now, I'd probably agree. Eddie Gilbert and that mystery partner, it must be something good, because Eddie Gilbert's got a smile, one of those Cheshire cat smiles on his face.
We're going to find out next week. And you know, another strong point about Luger and Sting as a team is that they are so close. They are such good friends. Certainly probably the closest two men tag team wise in the sport are Hawk and Adam of the Road Warriors. They're brothers. But there's been a closeness, a bond between Sting and Lex Luger that's existed, and I think it's really come into the ring also. You can see it, that they really trust each other.
Well, when the Road Warriors turned on Sting, who was the first man in the ring at his side? That was Lex Luger.
We go back through 1988 and think about what happened to Luger, how he was betrayed at one time in Jacksonville, Florida. Speaking of the NWA coming back there. Got a friend he can trust right here at Sting, and there's the bear hug once again.
These guys can beat you with the power moves like the bear hug. Our fans, they can beat you through the air just like this. Upstairs or downstairs, and then it will be, perhaps, and indeed it is, the Scorpion Deathlock. He may be a Scorpion Deathlock away from his first major championship. In any event, he and Lex Luger are an awesome combination in any atmosphere.
All right. A win for Luger and Sting. Here's the Stinger Splash, followed by the Scorpion Deathlock. Quite a combination. Now, fans, don't forget that Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert has his special, I guess, mystery partner next week to go up against Ric Flair and Barry Windham. You'll see it on World Championship Wrestling. Now the total package and Sting with Jim Ross.
Thanks very much, Tony Schiavone. We were talking about the situation involving you and Ric Flair. He's made the statement. Everybody, it's worldwide and everybody knows. He says he's not going to wrestle you again. But I want to say this, that I admire your attitude. You have not cried. You've not said, well, I got a raw deal. You're an athlete and a man's athlete, and I admire that personally.
Flair says it's finished, does he? Well, I don't care if a guy with a suit and tie says it's finished, sit behind a desk or a promoter or smooth-talking Slick Rick says it's over. It's over. When the total package, Lex Luger, says that it's over. And that's the bottom line, Nature Boy. Because you see, the two biggest matches of the year, that's Baltimore, July 10th, I had your beat. And the next biggest show was Starrcade. True Grit, I dominated the match. I had it won. If you got a little help from your four-legged friend. And it wasn't a dog, it wasn't JJ on his hands and knees. And it was a steel chair. If that's the true champion, if that's the man you want to be, that's fine. But somebody, and it might as well be a total package, and give people the true champion. And think of myself, 1989, on a team, we're going to do it all.
And I tell you something, Butch Reed's on his way. You know him well.
Yes, I know him well, and I know 1988 versus 1989. It's a dog-eat-dog world, and I'm one who realizes that more than anybody else, Rossi.
Thank you very much, fans. We'll talk to you next week.